And I'll say thank you.
Thank you.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
You get the praise.
You get the praise.
You take the honor. We'll say thank you.
Thank you.
You get the glory.
You get the glory.
Out of everything we do, Jesus.
You get the praise.
You take the honor.
You take the honor.
We'll say thank you.
Thank you.
Say you get the glory.
You get the
hey,
glory.
Father, we say you. Can we tell them all over the room? Hey, we just want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Come on, lift up your voice all over this room, all the thankful people. Oh,
glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Ooh, glory to God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Lord, in my life, be glorified, be magnified, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Oh, you're a mighty good God. You're a mighty good God. You're a mighty good God. What's up, family? Come on now, let's give God some praise. Glory to God. You are a mighty good God. Glory to God. When I think of your goodness, Lord, all that you've done for me, glory to God. Hallelujah. My soul, my mind, my will and emotions, Lord God, just cries out. Woo! Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you for saving me, for delivering me, for bringing me out. Glory to God for lifting me up. Praise God for healing my mind. Glory to God for setting my focus right. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. I could have been something, doing something else, being someone else. Glory to God. But you saw fit, God, to pluck me out of that space I was in. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Glory to God. Yes, when I look back and think of all those things. That's right, Yoana. Hallelujah. How you doing, Marinetta? How you doing, Keisha? Dottie? Glory to God. Come on, thank you. What are you thankful for? What are you thankful for? Put it in the comment box. What's up, Latasha? Hey, Tina. I think about it, man. I was back in the day out in the streets just living mindlessly, okay, mindlessly. Not thinking about consequences, just, you know, thinking about just feeling good. Just and so which means I was doing stuff that helped me to feel good. I was getting high. I was doing some drinking, not a whole lot of drinking. I didn't really like the taste of liquor like that, but I was just trying to anesthetize my pain. Just so I wouldn't think about my frustrations, think about my hurt, think about those things that was causing me pain that I didn't have answers to. I mean, I was just lost. But even in those dark days, God kept me. I mean, I can look back and see how I could have got caught up. I could have been, I really shouldn't, if I would have gotten caught up at the pace I was going, I would not be here right now. Because I didn't think about limits. I didn't think about, you know, that's enough. I didn't think about it. I mean, if I can consume it, I would do it. But there were certain things I just wouldn't do. You know, I just thank God during that time of the crack, you know, wave. I was like, not interested in that. Don't want to actually do that. You know, not really thinking about those. I didn't think about like needles. No, I didn't want to do that. Not interested in that. I just thank God that certain things just did not intrigue me. And I said, I don't need that to get y'all. Listen here. I was like, I don't need that to get high. I could do this to get high, you know? And so there's certain things I just wouldn't do. And those things I said I wouldn't do, wasn't interested in doing, saved my life. But I realized it wasn't me. It was just the Holy Spirit just arresting me, not, you know, the Lord does not allow me to be intrigued by those things. I'm thankful and I'm grateful. Come on, anybody know what I'm talking about? You got to think about those things. Elaine's, I woke up pain-free for the past 3 days. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. Guarding your heart and mind. Let's go, let's go. Come on, God is such a good God. Just think about where you could have been, what you could have been doing, caught up. And I'm just so thankful. Man, y'all got some good stuff kept. Oh, Keisha, thank you. That's awesome. Glory to God. Yeah, the Holy Ghost just arresting me. Just nothing. Don't do that. Y'all, I was just really just caught up. I was a young person in the city, you know? You know, my mother used to put me on punishment, and I had no idea because some of the punishment didn't make me any sense. But my sister was saying she just wanted to keep you from being out in the streets. And I just loved the streets. I did. Street life. Oh, my goodness. That was my thing. I was like, let's get out there where the lights and the things are happening. And God was like, you know, Dolores, watch your daughter just get her for anything. And that's exactly what she did. I was in the house for the summer. During my high school years, it wasn't nothing for me to be on punishment for the whole summer. For the whole summer. Yeah. Yeah. That's what she did for me. You know, hey, Bernadette, Sandra, Allison. Allison, did you feel the earthquake in the New York, the tri-state area? We have some spiritual children in New Jersey said there was a 4.7 or 8 earthquake. It's a discrepancy there. News are going back and forth from 4.8, 4.7. Anywho, it was an earthquake. 4 point whatever is pretty significant for the New Jersey, New York, D.C. area. They said something from New Jersey all the way up to D.C. That's pretty significant. That's pretty 4 point whatever. For the first time, that's pretty significant. They said buildings just kind of rattled. I mean, New York City and all those buildings. Oh, my goodness. I just thought about that. I was like, wow. interesting times. Scripture speaks of a diverse place, earthquakes, and divers, different, various, random. That's a better word. Random places. That's what the word says. And that's exactly what's happening. I know the Elgin area was having a whole bunch of tremors. You know, yep, Marinetta, you know, 4.8 earthquake in New Jersey. That's really unusual, okay? Unusual. While I'm here in the Charleston area, it's kind of chilly, y'all. It's chilly, which is why my voice is like, I'm having some actual challenges, either from the weather or from my husband, who has been battling with some type of head cold, respiratory, whatever. And y'all, coughing and covering his face or sneezing is something very foreign to him when he's in his home. He'll do it in public. But at home, he lets it rip. I'm like, yo, yoo-hoo, I'm here. I need you to cover that up. I need you to cover that up. But other than that, it's a good day in the neighborhood. It's a good day in the neighborhood. Thank you, Karen. It's a good day in the neighborhood. God is good. God is faithful. Amen. God is just showing himself strong. Prayerfully, all of you have had a good week. How's your week been? How you doing? What's going up? Going down? Your mom sounds like, just kept us in the house, huh, Francis? Just kept us in the house. My mother's like, mm-mm, not letting you out. Okay, I see you. Mm-mm. What? Punishment went for the whole summer. For the whole summer? Who does that? Who does that? Who does that? Thank you, Robin. Very relaxing week. Awesome. That's right. Spring break week, right? So you didn't have to go into school. Chill week. Good. I'm glad you relaxed this week. Put your feet up. Listen, I slept to 8 o'clock. 8:30 every day this week. Very rare for me. But I got my sleep in, got my rest in. I'm really grateful for that. I was deliberate. We stayed in church. Yes, you did, Marinetta. I mean, wait a minute, because Marinetta, she stayed in church. I'm familiar with the church she's used to stay in, because I attended the church in New Jersey. So all day Sunday, okay, literally, sacrificial prayer, Sunday school, service, and then come back for 4:30 service on Sunday, y'all. Then on Wednesday, then on Friday, stayed in church. It was not much you can do, right? Not much you can do, you know? So I had a good week. I slept in, got some rest. I brought my sneakers to work out. Did not do that, but I got some rest, y'all. I got some rest. Much needed rest for me. Much needed rest. Yes, yes, yes. Well, let's prepare to receive our offering. I thank God for all of you, you know, for your faithfulness and to your giving, to returning your tithe. Say return your tithe, because it's God gives us the ability and the power to get wealth. I was meditating on this passage of scripture before I actually came on today. It's Deuteronomy, the 8th chapter, you know, and the 18th verse. I'm reading from the Amplified Translation, and it says, "But you shall remember." I just got stuck at remember, which means we have a tendency to forget. It's a possible potential, the possibility, the probability that you may forget, because the scripture tells you, you shall remember. Anytime you see that in the word, that means there's a probability, the potential to forget. So be conscious, be intentional, okay? And be deliberate. It said, with profound respect. Wow. With profound awe, deep, you know, intentional respect the Lord your God. So respect is not like, oh yeah, respect God, but you can't see that you respect God, or you can't hear that you respect God. It's definitely obvious, with obvious respect, you know, with deep respect, okay? For it is he who is giving you power to make wealth, that he may confirm his covenant, which he swore solemnly promised to your fathers, as it is this day. So God gave a word to someone that I'm going to bless you, I'm going to keep you, I'm going to strengthen you, not just you, but your children. So God wants us, and he's telling us in a passage of scripture here that Moses wrote, that we must definitely, deliberately remember when God increases us, when God blesses us, that we never forget it was him that's given us power to get wealth. Don't forget where you came from. Don't forget it was him that has blessed you. My God, can you imagine? You know, and it happens, you know, I've seen it happen, that there's times as people, you know, were on the brink of making it or needing God to do something, to bless them, to come to the prayer line, needing a job, believing God for purpose, and then all of this happens for them. It happens by the power of God. They're so excited. They give their testimony. They like, look what the Lord has done, right? And then post what he has done, you don't see them. Okay, you don't see them. You don't see them financially. You don't see them physically. Sometimes you don't see them online. Why? Because they're really busy and doing what they were, felt like they were called to do, God purposed them to do, their vision for their life. My vision, and people say my vision. I think I did a post on this one time. That we say my, but it's God's vision for your life, okay? And that we can never forget that it was him that placed these dreams, placed these desires in you. And so God said, I need you to remember that it's me that brought this opportunity in your life so that the blessing, the promise can be perpetuated throughout your bloodline. And so this is something else that I'm thinking about. It's all one huge relay race. That where we are and what we're doing, it's about, if we think along the line that I'm passing this baton to my seed or to someone else, you'll think about how you carry the baton. You'll think about how you run with this baton. You'll think about how you operate and function with this baton, because this is about passing this on to somebody else. And God said, I need you to think like that so that you're not, what I like to say from time to time, a one-hit wonder, that you blow up and that you do some stuff that nobody else have seen done before in your family, and that's it. That is it. No, guys, I don't want it to be it. I want it to be transferable. My God, I want you to leave an inheritance to your blood, within your bloodline, that this barrier, which we're going to talk about, has been broken, and you're going to keep it open. You're going to keep it open. That is not just about yourself, okay? So you got to deal with that whole selfishness. You got to deal with that whole lack or poverty mindset that makes you feel like you can't share, you can't stop. But I want you to share what God has done for you. And I want you to stop and take note of what he's done for you, that you give him the praise, that you give him the glory, and that you give him the honor. And the way we do that is we return our tithe. Here we go. This way to give, go to rdci.info/give, or you could text 844-624-1200. Text RDCI to 844-624-1200, or you can mail it into a P.O. Box, 21672 Columbia, South Carolina, 29221, or drop it off at our physical address, our admin offices, 1234 St. Andrews Road. Amen, amen, amen. Father, I just thank you, Lord God. Yeah, no one hit one is here. We thank you, Father God, that we understand it's you that give us power to get well. So we thank you, Lord God, for blessing the work of our hands. And we return our tithe, Father God, and we allow you to speak to us regarding our offering. And we give you the praise, we give you the glory, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. God bless you. Thank you for your giving. And I want to give you a few announcements here. Pass the baton to your seat. Come through, Jesus. Come through. Come through. That's what we're doing here. Listen, tomorrow, okay, we got Zumba. Okay, Zumba with Michelle J in Kidstown at 10 a.m. So you want to move your body? You want to move your body? Show up. Listen, it's a great opportunity to keep moving that scale in the right direction. And church anniversary concert, mark your calendar. Mark your calendar. We have Miranda Curtis. She'll be in the house at 6 p.m. We're celebrating 28 years of ministry, and we thank God for what he has done. And so Miranda Curtis, not just for one song, not for two songs, a concert, y'all. Free general admission. We have limited VIP tickets available at rdci.info. And those tickets are for $25. We're going to have a great time. We're going to give God the praise. We're going to celebrate the Lord. And we're going to thank God for all that he has done for us. Praise God. 28 years of ministry. God is, it is you. It is you. It is you. Glory to God. We give you all the glory, all the honor. Okay. And that VIP ticket includes preferred parking and reserved seating and a VIP reception with refreshments. That's a lot, y'all. That's a lot for $25. I just want to let you know. So you better jump on that. Okay. Preferred parking, reserved seating, and refreshments for $25. Listen, jump on that. Mother-daughter tea, Saturday, May 4th at 12:30. We're celebrating the bond of motherhood between daughters and mothers. And the theme is like mother, like daughter. The cost is $25. There's a QR code you can scan. Register, please, by April the 14th at imswata.org. Every time I look in the mirror, there's times I get glimpses of my mother, and it just blows me away, you know? And so there's so many similarities. I possess beyond the physical appearance, you know, her mannerism. And so even though my mother is no longer with me here on this side, I see her in my life. I see her through my actions. I see her through my mannerisms. So join us for Like Mother, Like Daughter, May 4th at 12:30. Limited seating, y'all. Limited seating. It's going to be a really good time. We brought back the Mother-Daughter's Tea by popular demand. So register now, y'all, while seating is available. And of course, I want to give y'all a heads up, okay? This coming August, This Is Us. This Is Us. Women's Conference. That's our theme. This Is Us. And we are finalizing the details. But I want to let you know, we have sponsorship packages that will be available. And it's going to be phenomenal. Okay. It's going to be phenomenal. Go to imswata now to register. If you desire to be a sponsor, to partner with us and what God is doing in SWATA, we are so excited that you would consider. Come on now. It's going to be phenomenal. Okay. 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 All right. I don't want to get off in my going down that rabbit trail. Start talking about the concert. Start talking about the conference. It's going to be great. Is going to be great. So let's pray. Father, I just thank you, Lord, for who you are. I thank you, Lord God, for your faithfulness. I thank you, God, just for being with us, God. There is no one like you, God. We magnify you, God. We glorify you. Holy Spirit, rest on this time. Shine your revelatory light. Speak to us. Speak to us, God, and give us direction and order our steps and lead us in the way we should go. And I thank you, Lord. Father, I thank you that you just think through my mind, speak through my vocal cords. Thank you, Lord God, for focus. Thank you, Lord God, that I say exactly what you desire me to say, Lord God, in Jesus' name. Amen, 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 amen. Praise God. Y'all, my throat is trying to give me the business. The devil is a liar. All right. Today's message, okay, the barrier breaker woman. The barrier breaker, okay? The barrier, and specifically the barrier breaker woman. We don't have to change the actual title, okay, on YouTube. But it's specifically the barrier breaker. And this word that God's speaking to me, I've been thinking about this for a minute and what kind of really actually, you know, solidified this moment to really gather you around this word that God's speaking to me that I'm still processing. I was watching a Netflix movie on Shirley. Has anybody seen Shirley? Has anybody seen Shirley? Well, Shirley Chisholm, a congresswoman. Okay, congresswoman. I think she died in the 80s. I think she died in the 80s, but she was the first African-American woman to run for Congress and or get into Congress. I don't know if for run. And then she also ran for presidency. And she was a barrier breaker, okay? She was a barrier breaker. Oh, good, good. It was good. It was good. I agree. It was good. It was so good that it just had me just thinking, really just thinking, thinking about her life, thinking about her grit that she had to have, her determination, her thick skin. Not only was she a woman, but she was Black during a time where it's completely unheard of. And not only that, some people thought she was crazy to even think that she could even do what she was doing. Like, you know, not just, you know, from her opponents, but from the people that she loved, or the people that she lived with, the people within her community. They thought she was crazy for thinking, number one, you could even run for Congress. You know, and so because when you're the first, you know, and sometimes that first is it's progressional, or it's depending on depending on your sphere. You might not be the first that's ever been done, period, but it could be the first in your family or the first in your group of friends, your sphere of influence, you know. You know, it all dependent. It could be the first in whatever social group you may be. You participate in or live in or abide in, or it could be an era, it could be a time, it could be your race, it could be your gender, it could be your family, it could be your friends. Okay, so she was the first. And so as a result of it, you know, that the chatter, the harassment, the criticism, the negativity was unbelievable. And for her to have such a determination was mind-boggling, okay? It was mind-boggling, and so much so that she would come across very oppositional and very headstrong and stubborn. Like, she wouldn't take anybody's advice. But I get it. I get it. Because she dealt with so many people saying, no, no, no. What makes you think that she closed her ears? And so she really focused on being led. And the movie portrayed that she was a spiritual woman, you know, that she had a relationship with the Lord, because she would refer to certain attributes that are Christian, you know, the love of God and forgiveness, what have you. So I saw that and I said, oh, gosh. And I started thinking about that. She broke the glass ceiling, right? The glass ceiling. Rochelle, you are doing something spectacular. It's relevant. It's relevant. It's relevant. So, oh, this is so good. I'm going to touch on. I'm going to try to stay focused here. I pray for focus. Okay. So it's all relevant, though. So here she was, you know, breaking that glass ceiling. You ever heard the term of the glass ceiling, breaking the glass ceiling? And I knew it was going to take some time with this because I'm really unpacking it and processing it myself, right? The glass ceiling. I looked this thing up, breaking the glass ceiling definition, okay? It's the barrier of advancement in a profession, especially affected women and members of minorities. It's the first. It's the first. It's the first. So we talk about the first, breaking the glass ceiling, and it's the first. And so, but it's say we call it a glass ceiling because you can see the opportunity, you can see the positions, you can see the roles, right? You can see it, but there's a barrier blocking you from getting it. And so, Shirley Chisholm, regarding being a woman and being an African American woman, she broke that glass ceiling in the area of Congress. And when you see that, when it opens up very quick, and you, if you watch it, you got focus because it moves fast. It jumps from one era, one time in season to her going for presidency. But I know there was some time in between there. Show her taking pictures with her colleagues, her other congressmen. And you saw her as the only African American woman, right? Just standing there with all these men. And so that glass ceiling, when the ceiling breaks, glass falls, right? And I start thinking about that. Being a glass ceiling breaker, you have to deal with falling glass. Just think about that. When glass falls on you, what's the potential to happen? What can happen when glass hits you? What can happen? You can get cut. Glass cuts. Glass cuts. So there is a risk factor of dealing with hurt and discomfort when you are a glass breaker, barrier breaker, barrier breaker. So let's go to Micah. The second chapter, the 12th verse, and it says, I will certainly gather all of you, O Jacob. I will certainly assemble those Israelites who remain. Woo! So, of course, this is a prophetic word regarding God gathering his people. And then those who remain, meaning there is a potential of those who falling away, walking away, leaving the Lord. He's, I will bring them together like sheep in a fold. He's, I'm going to bring my people together. I'm going to gather them. I'm going to bring them together like sheep in a fold. And I'm going to bring sheep in a fold. There's a barrier of protection. Okay. Like a flock in the middle of a pasture, they will be so numerous that they will make a lot of noise. Wow. So, women of God, guys, I'm going to gather you. I'm going to bring you smack dab in the middle of the pasture, in the middle of this place, in the field, where there's provision, where there's vegetation, and you're going to make a lot of noise. Oh my goodness, people are going to hear you, recognize you, see you. There's going to be a celebration. Mm-hmm. The one who can break through barriers will lead them out. Okay, this is a prophetic word about Jesus. The one who will break through barriers will lead them out. They will break out and pass through the gate and leave. Glory to God. The king will advance before them. The Lord himself will lead them out. Glory to God. So here you have Jesus, the supreme, the ultimate barrier breaker. Okay. The supreme, the ultimate barrier breaker. That's who Jesus is. And this is a prophetic word about Jesus, the barrier breaker, which he has done. He has torn down, ripped the barrier of separation between God and man. Okay. And can I add heaven and the barrier and the wall from earth, from heaven, between earth and heaven, ripped that and said, there's access. And not only do you have access, I'm going to lead you out of this place of restriction. I'm going to lead you out from behind the fence. I'm going to lead you out from my wall of containment He said, and said, now I'm going to lead you out. And the Jesus himself is going to go before us. And he's done just that. And so the word for us today, women, that God had broken down these barriers. He's broken down walls of containment. Let's move out. Let's continue to break through these barriers. As he is, so are we in this world. So God is calling us in this season. I really believe this, that God is raising women up, and he's raising us up not just to become, all right? He's calling us to break through. He's calling us to be that barrier breaker, to follow Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and the breaker himself. My God, right there, that he broke down barriers. And there's no time for us to wonder and consider or try to figure out or to doubt, but to believe that he's with us. Glory to God. Believe that his hand is on us for good, and to trust him as we go from this place of limitations into a place of expectation. He's calling us to break barriers, and breaking barriers, y'all, as I said, is an uncomfortable thing. It's an uncomfortable thing. If you watch that movie with Shirley, she dealt with a lot of negativity and she dealt with rejection. And she was ostracized by some of her family members because she thought she was better than them. When you refuse to be contained, when you refuse to be limited, when you refuse to think that this is as good as it gets, when you refuse to think that, you know, that you have limits, and you go to do more or believe that there is more than what you are experiencing right now in your life, some of your family members will say, oh, you think you're better than everybody else. You think you got more going for yourself than everybody else. No, I don't think that. I'm just trusting God. I just see something. There's something on the inside of me that's calling me, and it's telling me that I need to keep believing God, keep pressing forward, keep reaching for this goal, reaching for this mark. Let's go to Psalm 68 and 6. I'm reading from the Amplified Translation. God places the solitary in families, okay? When you think of a solitary, you could also look at a stone. A diamond is considered a solitaire. A stone is considered a solitaire. So God places this jewel in families and gives the desolate a home in which to dwell. Isn't this good? He leads the prisoners out to prosperity, but the rebellious dwell in a parched land. Okay, let's keep that passage of scripture up right there. So God places a solitaire, this individual, okay, is individual in families. And he gives people a home, a place, a territory, a purpose to dwell in, to occupy. Mm-hmm. And then he says he leads the prisoners out to prosperity, that he's placed this one individual in a family, several individuals in a bloodline. And he said, and I'm giving you a territory, I'm giving you an assignment, if you allow me to say, and which for you to occupy. And I want you to lead those individuals out who think they can't have it, think they can't be, or never seen certain things before. You lead them out and say, oh no, it can be done. It can happen. Yes, this is something that exists out here. I know there's people in our family who's never done, who never have, and never went. Yet, no, you can be, you can have, you can do. He wants you to go get the fruit, to show them the fruit. I don't know about any of you, but sometimes we think, we may wonder, it's like, you know, why was I born into this family? Have anybody felt like that? Why? I feel like I don't fit in my family. I feel like I'm just so different. Okay. And so he said, but I placed you there. God said, I placed you in that family. I placed you there. Okay. I purposely placed you there. You're not incidental to your family. So you almost got to look at it as an assignment. Sometimes we look at an assignment in what we do, you know, in church or regarding your purpose, maybe regarding a vision that God has given you. We see that as an assignment, but we don't see our families, woo, this is so good to me, as an assignment. If we see it as an assignment, okay, we got to shift our perspective and shift how we look at things and how we think about things. And then also it will enlarge our capacity of tolerance, okay? Enlarge our capacity even for empathy or sympathy, because you realize they don't get it and you won't take it personal. Woo. So you're born to a family, you know, and you wonder why do I live here and not there? If I was born over there in this state, I would have more opportunity. I will have more, you know, access. I'll be able to do certain things. Okay, that's what you could think. Or it's like, oh, okay. Oh, if I was born in a particular time, I'll be able to like, I would be, I mean, man, if I was born in the 80s, you know, and I'll be able to do X, Y, Z. If I was born, we look at times, you look at generations, like, man, why was I born in 1964? Why couldn't I have been born in 1980s? Or why couldn't I have been born in the 50s or 60s? I don't know about you. I'm like, nah, not for me. But this, sometimes you think about those things, but God is very, he's purposely, he said, I placed you. So I want to announce to some of you, you know, and you see this in Esther, this passage of scripture I'm referencing, this what I'm speaking to, that Mordecai tells Esther when she was concerned about being found out that she was a Jew, and she was afraid of her life. Okay, losing her life, afraid for her life. He tells her, don't go natural, don't go superficial, don't go surface. Don't just think about yourself, okay? Think mission. This is good. Think assignment. For such a time as this, that your people are being threatened, the Jewish people was facing a threat of being annihilated, and being killed, being taken out. Okay, there was a plot against them. And so Esther was queen, and she was living in a palace. Her identity, her ethnicity was not revealed. Her cousin, Mordecai, we call her uncle, but wasn't her cousin, had told her to hide her identity. Don't tell people you're Jewish. You know, and there was a purpose in that. But at this point in time, Mordecai said, we need you now. Go speak to the king on our behalf. Okay. And she's like, I haven't been asked for. If I try to break customs and tradition and I go before the king, ask him for an audience, I could lose my life. But then he tells her, for such a time as this, you were born, you were placed in the kingdom. Okay. For such a time as this. So for such a time as this, if you feel like you are outsider, an outcast in your own family, think mission. You were born and placed in that family, okay? If you feel like an outcast, rejected by your community, for such a time as this, you were placed in this community, okay? That you don't need to blend in. You need to be authentic. I spoke about authenticity on last week. You need to go back. If you missed it, you need to go back and watch it. But, you know, that you need to be authentically who you are to do what God has called you to do. You know, not just outside your home or outside your family, but in your home, in your family. Okay, so I placed you in this family. I placed you as a solitary. So a solitary, like I said, is a precious stone. If any of you have a ring on your finger, you could just take a look at it. If you have a diamond, one stone. If you don't, you have multiple ones, you can still see that. It's cut, okay? It's angled. And somebody had to do the work to make it look this way. And when a solitaire is being perfected and being shaped into the shape that the jeweler wants it, he cuts it, he chisels it, then he also sets fire to it so that he can, solidify and purify the shape and the stone. So it's a process for that solitaire. It's a process for it to shine. It's a process for the brilliance to be seen. And I just think it's so powerful that the scripture says that he places the solitary. So embedded in all of that word is the process, is the discomfort, it's the pain, it's the testing, it's the fire that a person, that solitary endures, so the brilliance to be seen. Okay, are y'all with me? Are you rolling with me? Are you riding with me? Okay, somebody say, I'm riding with you, Pastor Marsha. I'm rolling with you. So many of us, okay, the very thing that we need to be seen as that person that God is calling us to be in that season, that he's crafting you, shaping you to be, is the very thing you're resisting. It's the very thing you resist. And so what happens, many of us, because God is not going to strong arm us, especially not this season. He's not going to strong arm you. He's not going to coax you. He's not going to beg you. He's going to let you be. We are half finished. We're not perfected as that solitaire. We resist it to the process. And when we resist it to the process, you become average. You're not uniquely designed. You're unfinished work. So you may go into the imperfected batch versus the perfected batch. You know how that goes. The imperfected batch goes to the knockoff stores. TJ Maxx, I'm not going to name it because you can find some good stuff, but you look in there. The reason why it made it to this group is it may be a slight imperfection of colorization, of stitching, what have you, that doesn't meet the designer's eye. Does not come up to the designer standard. Okay, this is so good. Somebody said, I'm riding. Okay. Woo, I knew I wasn't going to get far, but it's okay. We're going to unpack this and we're laying a foundation. My daughter is married to a designer and he's so low-key, like really good, and he don't blow his own smoke. But you know, there's some stars that wear some of his designs, and he's designed for some major labels, and he created certain polo branch items. And I'm like, he's really, really good. So I'm like, oh, Kendra show me pictures of different stars in Hollywood wearing some of his things. I'm like, wow. She said, yeah, he's low-key really good, Ma. But he don't brag. He just, he don't, self-promote himself, what have you. He just does what he does, okay, which I love, okay? So he's very unassuming, He don't carry himself like all that he should. So he made family shirts for our vacation. And they were nice. They were young. We was like, oh, these are hot. These look so cool. So we loved it, and he made those for us. And then a couple of weeks later, a month later, Kendra said, we're sending you some more t-shirts. We're like, well, why? He said, well, Jamel sees the imperfections in the color and it doesn't meet his standard. I was like, we can't tell. Any of these shirts are great. He said, no, he can see the shading is just not right. So what does he do? Oh, this is so good. So he said, I'm replacing. Hey, oh my goodness. I'm replacing the shirts. They're not up to my standard. They're not up to my standards. I'm sending out a new batch. And when we got these new shirts, I looked at the old, I looked at the new, and I really couldn't tell too much of a difference. But to me, they look the same. But the designer of the church, he knew the difference. Ooh, this is so good. All right, so what's happening? I said during the New Year's Eve service that the Spirit of the Lord is going through the camp, right? Joshua sent the captains to go through the camp to tell the people we're getting ready to move out. And I really believe that the Spirit of God is moving through the camp, the house of God. And he's looking at the things that he had placed in the house. And he's seeing where we are in this whole process, right? And so I really believe that we in a moment, okay, that if we just yield ourselves, if we just repent, hear me now, if we just say, yes, Lord, however, I believe this time on the clock to be in position to be used to the capacity that God has designed you to be used. But if we are resistant, oppositional, fighting, we are placing ourselves in a position to be in a place of unfinished imperfection. And God's going to say, people may not could tell. On the outside, you look okay, but God's like, you're not where I want you to be. You're not where I know you should be. You're good, but you're not what I want you to be. And I want to let you know we're at this place, y'all. So God said, I placed you as a solitaire, and I know the process has been uncomfortable. And some of us need to go like, okay, God, you know what? I've been fighting this and this, and I know it's been uncomfortable, and I wanted everybody just to celebrate me and tell me my stuff don't stink. But I'm going through this cutting process. I'm going through this pruning process. I'm going through the process through the fire, and it hurts. And I'm just like, you know, why you picking on me? Or why you're not celebrating me? Or why you always saying this about me? Rejecting, you know, the process. God, I won't reject this anymore. God, I just yield. Because I want you to do what you desire to do in me so I can be fit. I could be fit to be used. Glory to God. So God said, I placed you in this family. And some of us are in families that may not receive you or retreat you or love you the way you need to be loved. God said, you know, just hang in there, okay? Don't cut them off. Don't cut them off. Allow that treatment, okay? Hear me. Allow what you're dealing with to challenge you, to perfect you, to grow you up, to grow you up, okay? Okay, let me give you an example here. Let me break it down to you, okay? So sometimes as a woman, okay, in ministry, I deal with adversity. I deal with contrary winds. Okay. I deal with flaky winds. Okay. Let me explain. So I could have a service, I do something, and that's the time, okay, for people like to take breaks, to shift and go on vacation, not be on schedule, all that kind of stuff. And so I could have something that's pretty major, but I don't have the A squad or what have you. But in these times when sometimes I may not have that at all. So it used to bother me. And I'm like, I could see the difference of respect. I could see the difference of reception, all of that. And to me, I would look and say, do you realize if you just look at certain things, it wouldn't even make sense. But I would go through all of that. It would have me in a bad space. What have it? And the Lord began to say to me, Marsha, allow it to develop you and make you. Don't allow it to break you. So I learned to, even though I said, okay, I may not have during the times of segregation. Okay. You have schools, education, you got books. from 19, the schools used to have, the black schools used to have books from, let's say, if they're in the 60s, they have books from the 30s, okay? And so they would have outdated stuff, broken stuff, old stuff. What happened? Hey, you just got this. Be happy. What are you complaining about? So it's just sometimes people do things in such a way they don't even realize that there's some discrepancies there, and they can't see it. They don't recognize it, right? So I realized, okay, I can't fight this like this all the time because I'm going to be exhausted. They're going to put me in a bad space. So what I learned to do is to work with what I have, to master my skill, to develop it in spite of the opposition I may get in sound that is not where it needs to be, or the opposition I may get with maybe not having any music, or the opposition, all those stuff. I learned to do what I need to do with all the enhancements. So when you deal with stuff like that, it helps you to really trust God, to lean on God, and be all that you know you can be without the bells and the whistles. But when the bells and the whistles show up, what it'll do is take you to a whole nother level. It'll take you to a whole nother level. So I want to encourage anybody who feel like they're getting second-class treatment, second-class stuff, second-class support, second-class help. I want you to tell you, hold your course. Grow. Develop. Sharpen your skill. Sharpen your ability, okay? So that when all the other stuff shows up, it just propels you beyond your capacity, beyond what you could ever imagine. Glory to God. Anybody understand where I'm coming from? Say, I hear you, sis. I hear you. Oh, I see the conversation. You know, I'm seeing the conversation, but I want to let you know. I just want to let you know, if you hold your course, so you wonder about these things, but God has ordered your steps. God is developing you. So sometimes he'll use uncomfortable situations. Sometimes God will use disappointment. Sometimes God will use you be in a situation where you have it to make do to develop you, to make you better. So what am I saying? As being a barrier breaker, I had to learn, I got to stop whining and complaining and do it. Do it. Do what God has called me to do. And that's what I'm telling you. Do what God has called you to do, how he called you to do, where he placed you. I can't believe my family. You know what? Just do you. Be who you are in that family, and don't allow your family chatter to change you, to cause you to withdraw, to damper your personality. The proof of who your authenticity is consistency. This is so good. The proof of your authenticity is your consistency in opposition, in rejection, in hardship. This is good. Acts the 17th chapter, the 26th verse, and he made from one common origin, one source, one blood, all nations of men to settle on the face of the earth, having definitely determined their allotted periods of time and fixed boundaries of their habitations, their settlements, their lands, and their abode. So God said, I placed you where you should live. I placed you at what time you should, what year you should be born. I fixed your boundaries, your habitation, your settlements, your lands, your abodes. One translation of Acts, the 17th chapter, the 26th verse says, in your territory. So God establishes your territory. God established when you should be born. God established your family. Nothing about you is a mistake. Nothing about you is incidental. Nothing about you is random. Somebody put it in the comment box, I'm not random. I'm not random. I'm not random. So God is calling us to go as women, to go where we have not gone before or seen anybody have gone before, to explore new frontiers. I'm going to order your book, Keisha, for my grandbabies. Okay? Keisha Williams' book. She wrote a book for children. I can't wait. I'm giving an order about 5 of them, okay? God is calling us as women to go where we have not gone before, to explore new frontiers by faith. So he may be calling some of you who've gone where you have not gone before. Like Keisha wrote a book, I'm a Big Deal. I'm a Big Deal. That's the book for children. I'm a Big Deal. So I don't know if anybody in her family had ever written a children's book before. I don't know if she told anybody that she was writing a children's book. I don't know what type of atmosphere reception she got when she mentioned that she was writing a book. She owns a daycare. I don't know what the type of atmosphere reception when they heard that she was going to do a daycare center. How you go from working in one area of business to another. She really crossed, she really changed mountains. She was working in finance, okay? We're going to call it finance, okay, Lady Keisha? She was walking and working in finance, and she went to education. I'm sure people are trying to figure out, what? That don't make any sense. No, it made God sense. God ordering the steps. So as a woman, somebody in her family, or maybe somebody that she in her with her people that she may know, like, what's going on? Sometimes we make moves, we're doing things, and you can feel the questions in the room. They may not ask you the question, but you can feel it, or you can sense it. And so as barrier breaking women, barrier breakers, we can't allow what we feel. We can't allow what we hear to stop you from making moves. Oh, this is so good. So by faith, I'm going to make these moves, even though I may look crazy to my crew, to my family, to the family God placed me in, or the community that God placed me in, or in the relationships that I'm in. They may say, oh, she crazy. You got to be okay with the looks. You got to be okay with the whispers. You can't allow it to stop you. So to break barriers, we, as barrier breaking women, we got to break through self-imposed limitations, limits imposed by social norms, customs, learned or implied. What am I talking about? So as barriers breakers who are women, we got to deal with self-imposed limits. I don't think I can do this. I don't know if I'm good enough. I don't know if I'm qualified. Those are self-imposed limits, okay? Self-imposed limits. Or they could be limits, I'm trying to get the scripture up here, that you may come across or through customs of the times. Women don't do that. Women can't be like that. Depending how old you are, if you from my generation, okay, my generation of women who are doing things now, we had to break through some barriers of being able to do this and that. You know, and sometimes for us in ministry, specifically in ministry, that as a woman in ministry married to a pastor, it was very unusual to have a source of a, trying to choose my words so very carefully, but I'm not, okay? To have a platform outside of your church or a platform outside of your husband. It looked like you were trying to, you know, break away or do something separate. And that was the chatter. And maybe that was for some women because how they were received in their ministries and church. But that's not with all, because sometimes some women have a voice, hear a voice of something that God is telling them to do, to be or become. So, I mean, that was the custom of that time. Okay, the custom of that time, you was our pastor's wife, you supported your husband, and that's basically all you did. And then came a custom of just like, okay, you're pastor's wife, then you're a co-pastor, and you do everything just with your husband. And now there's another custom, like you're a pastor's wife, but you can write your own books. You can have meetings. You can do establish something that God's speaking to you to create. And so there's different customs at different times and different seasons. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying? Somebody say, I'm hearing you. I'm getting it. I'm understanding it. I'm understanding what you're talking about, right? Okay. I'm trying to make sure you understand. So as women, we got breakthrough, whatever custom of the time that there is, you got break free from that. You can't allow it to shape you. You can't allow it to order your steps, dial it back, dim your light. Oh, this is so good. Okay. 2 Corinthians, the 6th chapter, 11th verse says, here's Paul saying, we are speaking freely to you, Corinthians, where we are keeping nothing back. He said, and our hearts is open wide. There's no limit to our affection for you, but you are limiting your own affection for us. And so, and I love how the Message translation puts it here. I'm going to find the Message real quick here. Let me see here. Message. My dear Corinthians. Okay, Message. Let me find it. Okay, I'm coming, y'all. Here we go. Dear Corinthians, I can't tell you how much I long for you to enter this wide open spacious life. We didn't fence you in. The smallness you feel come from within you. Your lives aren't small, but you're living them in a small way. So what I'm saying, look, we got to stop living our lives in a small way. We got to break out of those self-imposed limits, norms, customs, learned or implied. Okay. Barrier breakers will deal with implied stuff, suggested stuff, subliminal stuff, subtle stuff that may make you feel like that you, whatever, you're not supportive, you're doing the most, you're random, but we're establishing, we're not random. But this is something that you have to brace yourself for, okay? This is something that you got to realize it comes with the territory. So you got to face your fears, push past hurt, and persevere by faith. Okay. Face those fears of isolation and rejection. Push past the hurt of them. Okay. And persevere by faith. You got to persevere by faith. You can't wear your feelings on the sleeve. It will limit you. It will hinder you. It will cause you to look crazy. It will cause you to look random, irrational, okay? Don't wear your feelings on a sleeve. You have to develop a bounce back, a thick skin in the right places. Reason why I say in the right place, if you develop thick skin all over, your wall, that's what the devil desires you to develop, thick skin all over so that you are numb to the things of God. You're numb to the voice of God. You're numb to what the Spirit of the Lord is trying to lead you in, okay? But in the right places, you start being numb to all relationships. You're going to be numb to the wrong relationships. In the right places, because what happens, you get hurt, you start isolating, you start insulating and shutting yourself off from people. And you can't afford to do that. Barrier breakers As women, you need a community. You need a tribe. You need a sisterhood. You just got to find the right one, okay? You got to recognize, oh, when someone acts real flaky on you, real sometiming on you, you just go to the next. Understand, go to the next. Just move them from the proximity of your heart. They may not be bad people, but I just don't share with you what God is doing within me. I just won't have you close to my heart that you know my inward movings. Come on now, my inner thoughts. They may be a great time to go to the movies or have fun with, but I'm not going to talk about vision to you. I'm not going to share my dreams with you. I'm not going to share my goals with you. I just shift the proximity of you to my heart. So you got to develop thick skin in the right places. Okay, here we go. So when you encounter rejection, because you will, betrayal, you will, okay? You can only be betrayed by people who are close to you. That means it's something that you share with them that they expose to someone else, okay? And so those things will happen. Bounce back. Don't become a recluse. That's right. Keep it moving. You'll experience jealousy, envy, warfare, and just plain and simple navigating life. Now let's deal with this jealousy, okay? And let's deal with this envy thing because it's part of the territory. You can't allow it to mess with you. Jealousy, okay? And as women, sometimes we deal with this. We have to confront it. We experience it. And sometimes we personally deal with it. And I want to encourage you, don't allow it to be in you, okay? Don't allow it to be in you. I believe that James says when there's envy and jealousy, there's every evil work. You need the hand of God. You need the hand of God. You need the power of God. You need heaven working on your behalf, okay? Moving on your behalf. And so you don't need to give the devil access into what he is doing in your life. You don't need to give the devil access to interrupt God's flow in your life. That's James, the 3rd chapter, the 16th verse. Said, when there's envying and strife, there is confusion in every evil work. You got to deal with it. Okay. So jealousy, listen here, is feeling threatened or insecure that someone will take what you have. Jealousy is about two, or it's not just with two people, it's a third entity. Somebody gonna take your man, somebody trying to take your job, somebody take your place. That's what jealousy. You're feeling threatened by this individual's skill, looks, talent, or ability that they will replace you. Get it settled. Nobody can replace you. Nobody can be you but you. Okay? As women, okay? Because what happened, you will encounter other women who are jealous of you. They want what you have. It comes with the territory. But you got to get it settled. They ain't you, boo. They're not you. They can't have what God has for you. Can I be, as a pastor's wife, I mean, there's times where somebody has crossed boundaries or desire to cross boundaries. And as women, you can feel that vibe with other women, right? You can feel it. You know that, something ain't right about her. I don't trust her. Something like right. And that alarm will go off on the inside of you. But this is where I'm telling you, go to the next level. Okay. Because one thing I had determined in my life when I first started ministry, I don't have that energy. I don't have the energy nor the brain space to be feeling insecure in the space that God has placed me in. So I had to do the work and make sure that I was settled in who I was, understanding there'll be women will come and go, beautiful women, talented women, skilled women, all that kind of stuff. But they're not me. They're not me. And what God has given me, he has given me. He has given me. And the only way I can lose it is between me and God, not between somebody else, which is why I'm able to allow other women to operate in their gifting and talents and ability. Okay. I never forget, I met a pastor's wife. She was always like, that floozy, that hussy. I'm like, oh God, I can't do ministry like that. I just thought it was too much. Okay. So yeah, my husband looks good, but he with me. That's how I feel. He with me. I'm with him. So I'm not operating in that energy. So you have to, I'm one of barrier breakers. I'm talking to barrier breakers. I'm not talking to barrier livers. I'm talking to barrier breakers. Okay. Barrier breakers, be secure in the skin that you're in. Be secure in the skin that you are in. Okay. That you settle, that nobody can be you but you. Nobody can take from you what God has given you. Okay? Nobody. God has called you. God has anointed you. God has appointed you. And God has validated you. People will try to come in, have wrong motives and agendas, but let them figure that thing out by themselves, because what they will encounter is the backhand of the anointing. What they will encounter is something from the Lord. Okay. They would deal with, God will handle them. Okay. So you stay focused, you stay straight in those things and refuse to side eye women. Okay. Or be moved by a woman who will try to make you think she's in competition with you. She can't be. If you have it settled, she can't be in competition with you. She's in competition by herself. Don't play her games. Don't stoop down to her level. Anytime, oh, this is so good. Anytime you start playing that jealousy game, you coming off that seat that God has given you to occupy, and you playing at her level with her games and her tools and her toys. No, you're not on her level. She's trying to bring you to that level, so you settle it. You are who God has called you to be. She wants something that you have and she can't have it. So don't give it away. The way you give it away, if you try to fight for it. Is this helping anybody? I don't know why I'm here. I don't know why I'm here. Okay, envy. You long, you desire and want what someone else has. Now, this is between two people. It's you and the person, between two people. You look at somebody like, oh, I wish I had her house. Oh, I wish I had her shoes. Oh, I wish I had her clothes. Oh, I wish you long. And that's envy. And envy and jealousy sometimes are used interchangeably, but they are different. Jealousy is with three. Envy is with two. So he's like, hear me now by the Spirit of the Lord. If you are envious of somebody else's life, God can't bless your life. Because you're all in their life. You're all in their life. Stay in your life so God can bless your life. Okay? Be thankful for what God has done in your life. Be thankful for the shoes you have. Thankful for the house you have. Thankful for the clothes you have. Be thankful so he can bless it and increase it. But to long for what somebody else has. God can't bless you if you're someplace else. Woo! God can't bless you if you're someplace else. Envy and jealousy. When there's envy and jealousy, there's every evil work. I submit to you, my sisters, some of the opposition, the resistance, and the warfare that some of us have encountered is because we have envy and jealousy in our own heart. Whew. I think I'm quit for today. Put a pause on it. Somebody said, I'm a barrier breaker. I don't have time for envy and jealousy. I'm not in competition with anybody else. I'm going to worry about myself. I'm going to worry about myself. Worry about myself. Worry about yourself. I'm not in competition. Don't get in competition with other women. Don't allow other women who are operating in jealousy and envy, because sometimes it's a spirit, and you find yourself having these feelings and these thoughts, and you're trying to show them, prove to them, girl, you're head above them. You're head above them. Stay in your lane. Stay in your sphere. They can't be you because they're not you. They can't have what you have because they're not you. So therefore, you stay focused. Do what God has called you to do. Be consistent and keep hitting that barrier until it breaks. Keep hitting that wall, tapping on that ceiling until it breaks. And develop that thick skin. Say, I'm not going to be ultra sensitive, hypersensitive that tool, that it changes, alters, dims, cause me to dial it back. And I'm not, as I'm working on what God has called me to work on, do what God has called me to do, I'm not going to start side-eyeing other women who may look like they're further ahead than me, look like they have a different set of skills than me. I'm going to be grateful and thankful for the gifts and skills that God has blessed me with. Maximize them and occupy them. Use them so that I'm the best me I can be, because God's given me these set of skills to break the barriers that he has called me to break. Called me to break. I'm going to work what he has given me to work. I'm not going to look at somebody else's stuff. I'm not going to get competitive, and I'm not going to be drawn into competition. Praise God. Because I don't need that type of negative energy. I don't need to mess with that evil work energy. I need God's hand on me. I need the anointing that destroys yokes and removes burdens. Praise God. And you keep hitting that barrier. And so I focus on what God has given me. Some of us are working on the barrier within our families. God has called you to break out the cycle of dysfunction, the cycle of poverty, the cycle maybe of just drugs within your bloodline. That I'm going to break this barrier, God. I'm going to be sober. I'm going to seek you to bless the work of my hands. I'm going to work there, and I'm not going to despise that barrier. That's significant, because nobody in my family has done just that. You know, some barrier may be like, you know what, my marriage is going to work. And I'm going to break the barrier of divorce and separation. And I'm going to do just that, you know, or raise my children, you know, and I'm going to be involved in their lives. And certain things that plagued my family that, you know, the buck stops here. We're no longer going to, you know, we're going to be modest, or we're going to live holy, or my sons and my daughters going to keep themselves. And we're going to talk about abstaining, you know, abstinence. We're going to talk about those things, saving it for marriage. We're going to talk about marriage, you know. We're going to set that standard. We're going to set that bar, even though maybe somebody in your bloodline, we all live together. We all shack, you know. Nobody's married. No, I'm a barrier breaker. It's going to happen here. It's going to happen here. We're going to do this thing here. We're going to do it, I may scrape my knee. I may fall in it, but you know what? I'm developing thick skin. I'm going to get back up. I'm going to get back up. I may make a few mistakes, but this is what the barrier you call me to break, God. I'm going to get back up. I'm going to keep hitting it. I'm going to keep hitting it. I'm going to keep hitting it. Or the barrier may be in an area of employment that, you know, I'm going to be that one that's going to have a job, keep a job, you know, and, you know, not just going from job to job and sometimes not having a job. No, I'm giving you different examples of barriers, because sometimes the barriers we think of is doing something phenomenal, like, you know what? I'm not going to be Shirley Chisholm. You know, I'm not running for Congress. So I'm not longing to have her life. I'm not envious of Shirley Chisholm. nor jealous of what she has. I celebrate her, right? I'm going to work on my own barriers that God has called me to break. That's right. Stay in my lane. I'm going to run my race with patience. I'm happy in my lane. I'm loving it. I'm loving it. Y'all rocking it out today. You know, rocking it out. So, you know, I want my whole family to be saved. So you keep walking out salvation before your children, before your loved ones. You keep walking it out, you know. Let them see how the word is changing your life, okay? Let them see the impact of going to church in your life. Come on now. I'm telling you, we're in a time and a season to break barriers. The breaker has gone before us. Let's follow. Let's march with him. My God. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Man, this was good today. I'm so glad we had this time together. Amen. If you joined me after the offering, I want you to prayerfully consider if this word has been a blessing to you, you can go to rdci.info/give, or you can text RDCI to 844-624-1200 or mail it to our PO Box 21672, Columbia, South Carolina, 29221. And we thank God for you. Amen. If you're here with us today, have not received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, please take a moment, some time to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Pray this prayer with me. Father God, I thank you for your son, Jesus. I believe that you sent him to die on a cross and that he shed his blood for my sins. Right now, I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. Praise God. Just like that, you're part of the family of God. Please go to rdci.info/next-steps. Give us your information and we can make sure that we can get some information, next steps out to you. Glory to God. Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. Glory to God. Awesome, awesome. Thank you, Amber. Thank you, Carla, Vivian, Gail, Rochelle, Patricia, Keisha. Praise God. You know what? I'm in this space right now in my life that I'm really focused on sharing and giving women what they need to stay authentic, to stay strong, and to stay sane in their purpose and in what God is, and in their life. Why? Because the opposition is real. It can make you think or feel a particular way. So what I'm discovering, many of us are going into places, but our internal fortitude is causing us to implode, to second guess. So I'm going to be sharing at a deeper level and from my experiences and some from what I just know. And some things have kept me, you know what, the whole dynamic has kept me is like, you know, because I don't want anybody to think, oh my God, you know, what, you know, the whole dynamic of people feeling bad and all that kind of stuff. And I'm like, you know what, we don't have no time for that. So I just want to help women be the best they can be consistently and not implode, because it is what it is. You know, just like there's certain dialing back of certain things today because of powers that be feeling threatened, I believe is transcending to every demographic area based on your gender, your race, your ethnicity. Yes, that's it. A little tired and congested. But I believe, so what that means, we have to stand. We have to fight the right way. Keep going. Don't waste your energy, you know, with explaining yourself or fighting for yourself. Allow it to develop you, perfect you, make you better. Amen. Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Breaking the barrier of unforgiveness. That's good. My man, that's real, real good. Awesome, awesome, awesome. So, what y'all got planned for the weekend? Did I forget anything? I think I hit all the things I needed to hit. Awesome, awesome. Well, fight the right way. Yeah. I want you to do just that, my sister. Let's fight the right way. Don't waste your energy. You know, if I could tell you if I could really break down to you the opposition that I encountered doing what God has called me to do, we don't have time for it. So you just stay focused. I'm not everybody's cup of tea, and I don't have to be. I'm God's cup of tea. He brewed me just right for him. So some people may not get you. That's okay. You know, people say some random stuff. Sometimes on social media, people say random stuff and post, and I laugh. I do that laughing emoji back at them. And then I block them. I bother you, don't be on my page. So what am I gonna do? Listen, the weather, I didn't bring a curling iron, so which is why my hair is flat. I'm just like, you know what? I didn't bring a curling iron, and I didn't bring anything to wrap my hair with. So I've been wrapping my hair for the last couple of days, y'all, you won't believe this, with a tank top. I'm so glad it was stretchy, so I was able to. I just bought a scarf on yesterday. So I'm like, oh, well, usually it was like, I'll be like, oh my God, it would be a big thing. I'm like, mm-mm, it is what it is. Thank you, Takesha. You know, so, I wrapped it up with a scarf. It looks better today. It looked kind of rough last couple of days, but that's okay. It looks better today. Got a scarf and some oil. Okay, we're gonna lift it. We're gonna do whatever it can do. You know, say so. Thank y'all. So I think I'm gonna chill the rest of this afternoon a little bit. You know, my Bishop is a huge tennis fan, so we've been at the tennis. This is why I'm so froggy, because it's been so cold here at night. And so we've been going to matches at night, and I just wasn't prepared with clothing. Funny thing is, before we left, I was separating my clothes. I was putting my winter clothes away, and I was looking at my turtlenecks. I was looking at my scarves. I was like, real heavy sweatshirt. I was like, I don't need to bring that. And the thing about it is, because we were driving, it would not have hurt for me to throw it in a car. What am I saying? Don't talk yourself out of things that really won't make or break anything. Follow it through. So I was like, I really had a thought to bring one turtleneck, to bring a scarf, and to bring a heavy sweatshirt. I didn't do it. Nor did I bring a shower cap, y'all. I didn't bring a scarf. I was really trying to set myself up. And I didn't bring, you know, I mean, all of that. So I got a headscarf yesterday. And I bought a blanket, one of those blankets. And I've been wrapping myself all up in it, you know. Because something about the cold in my chest area, it just does something for me. So I like to block that and cover myself up. I think some air, I would feel the air. I think some air just got right here, or Bishop got to me. Thank you, Marnetta. I know the girls' game tonight. I want to see that. It's going to be so good. USC, let's go all the way. I mean, this season with women basketball has been phenomenal. They're breaking barriers, y'all. They're breaking barriers. And those barrier breakers on these teams are dealing with a lot of hate. And some people don't even realize where it's coming from. That's another thing that had me started thinking Yeah, are they doing a, you know, that their personality like the Angel Reese's and Flage, you know, from LSU, getting a lot of flack, you know, getting a lot of flack because what they've done for basketball, when adding all that flavor to it, being authentic, who they are, and their celebration and how they just do themselves, being youthful. It shows you, you know, it has caused them to break some barriers. You know, they didn't fit into a mold. They like, this is just who I am. But as a result of it, it has brought a lot of attention and eyes on women's basketball. Usually women's basketball coach Dawn Staley. She's done that for USC. Filled up arenas. My goodness. She's done some stuff that no coaches could do. A barrier breaker. USC women's basketball, barrier breakers. When you're a barrier breaker, you got to have some thick skin because everybody don't get down with you because they don't get you and your light makes them feel uncomfortable. How you do what you do because they don't do it like that makes them feel uncomfortable. And because you don't carry yourself apologetically makes them feel uncomfortable. And I'm just in a space of realizing it was a season of my life that I think I carried myself apologetically. I wanted everybody to feel comfortable with me. And at the end of the day, I've lived some time now that I realize no matter how I flip me, package me, do me, they still ain't comfortable with me because of who God called me to be. So I just might as well be me and do me at the greatest level I can do. So that's what's happening in the chatter. And they forget these are kids. I saw a picture of the USC women's basketball team leaving the plane or coming off the plane. You know, they were holding teddy bears. And I showed this to my husband. I said, see, these are kids. You understand? Kids. You know, and so when they foul out, when they lose, the chatter that grown people are saying about them is unbelievable. These are kids. They're not even 25 yet. Their brain is not fully developed. Back up off of them. They don't have to be the team you're rooting for. You know, deal with the game. You know, the skills. Don't attack the person. Don't attack them. Don't start calling them names. I don't get it, you know. I really don't get it. But, you know, so, like, and I'm like, these are kids. These are kids who are making a lot of money doing things at a level and in a space that people who have gone before them have not had the opportunity. Like when my son was playing sports, he was telling me, he's a mom. If I was playing basketball now, I would easily from NIL pull about $200,000 easily. You know, I do think some changes have to happen. That transfer portal is too crazy. You know, I think it's cutting down. It can fight up against cohesiveness of team building and team sports. They can go from one school to the next school. Like some of them have been to three schools. At the time when my son was playing basketball, if he transferred, he would have to sit out a season. Now you don't have to sit out. They should have never changed that. I don't know who did that. Sometimes it's okay just to like be loyal to that school who's giving you that opportunity. It's okay. Just work with the program. And then, the putting caps. Because what coaches used to do, coaching was all about mentorship and developing. Now you're dealing with young people who's all about the dollars. They can care about becoming a man, becoming a woman. I want to get paid. So it's becoming problematic for coaches. So you have some good coaches getting out of coaching. So this, you know, we buck wild right now. We need some wrapping up some to bring it back into the why, back into focus. You know, so. Yeah, most of the negative remarks come from people who have never been in that athletic space before. You are completely correct. I watch people who don't play the sport, never play the sport, be like shouting at people. I'm thinking, you don't know. You have no clue. Making fun of, like, when they lose, the team lose, making fun of that team. Oh, look at y'all, boo. Just celebrate your team. Celebrate your team. Don't hate on the opposition. They dealing with the loss themselves, you know? I don't know. It's real crazy. So I've been watching all of this and, you know, and just, I mean, at this time, my kids are grown, but talking to my grands. One thing I'm thankful for, my mom, you know, which helped me position me to confront and deal with jealousy and envy, because she's like, Marcia, don't be a catty woman. Don't be jealous. You celebrate that woman. You celebrate that girl. You know, you let, you know, celebrate who she is. She was constantly talking to me about that. She said, she's part of your community. You know, she's within your team. Sometimes we could be friends or what have you. She would not get me something because someone else has it. You know, she, you know, once I said because someone else has, she said, no, no, no. We're not going to do that because of that. We're not going to do the keep up with Joneses. You know, you didn't want that until you saw someone else have it. Now tell me why. I had to explain why I wanted it. Why do you want it? I could say because so-and-so, because Kim has it. She's like, mm-mm, no. That's not a good enough reason. So, you know, so she helped me to deal with that whole competitive thing. You know, she's like, I need you to not get in that. Don't walk like that. Don't think like that. Don't, you know, I need you to see where that's coming from. And it's beneath you. It's beneath you. So I just want to encourage you as women, us as women, especially here. That we celebrate, truly celebrate each other, and not in a fake way, but in a real way. And then you celebrate them authentically, not because you feel like they need it, you know? And really in an authentic space, you know? So I just want to encourage you. You know, this is something, this is so weird to me. Okay, this is weird to me. So if you compliment me publicly and never compliment me personally, I don't think it's real. I don't think it's real. So what am I saying? Public compliments without personal relationship, you know, a personal moments when you have, some people don't have that opportunity, I get it. But if you have that opportunity, talk to me and tell me, I receive it better privately. I've received it as being authentic sometimes. But sometimes people don't have that opportunity. Now I'm talking about relationships-wise. Like if my husband only tells me stuff publicly, let me break it down. Because people are like, oh my God, you know, I'm not talking about y'all. But I'm talking about people in my family, people I'm in relationship with. If you never tell me something personally and then wait to tell me something publicly, I think it's more about you than me. That is just me. You know, I could be weird. I'm a little different. I'm a little different. So, yeah, go figure. You know, but that's just how I'm wired. So people in my life kind of actually know that. You know, I'm a stickler for authenticity. I'm a stickler for authenticity. And some people do stuff for a show. For show. I'm like, mm-mm. Yeah, for show. Don't tell me I'm all this publicly and say nothing to me privately. I'm like, do you really mean it? You know, so. I don't know. That's just me. So just want to encourage us as women. you know, that check our hearts, because I really believe God is calling us to really do some phenomenal things in life. And that category of phenomenal will be relevant to where you are. Okay. I'm not a D.D. Freeman. Okay. And she's doing some phenomenal things. It would be envious of me to want to do what she does, because she's D.D. or Taffy Dollar or Cindy Trim. So I don't covet what they're doing. I want to do what God has called me to do. And I stay out of envy, be like, oh, I ain't doing nothing. Oh my God, look at all the women they got. Look at where they're going. My life is nothing. I'm being envious. I'm eyeing her life, and God can't bless my life because I'm trying to travel through her space. Live in your space. Think of my space. My space. So, and you're making a difference at the level you're making, God has called you to make, to the people that count the most. Amen. Your tribe, your village, your community. Amen. All right, y'all. I love you, ladies. Have a great weekend here in Charleston. Very sunny. Very, very sunny. So enjoy the weather. Have a great day.